So I'm going to cover misconceptions, understanding vulnerabilities, and then best practices. So number one misconception, actually the main misconception, is WordPress is insecure. So this is wrong. WordPress is written on top of PHP. And how secure it is depends on what kind of plugins you use, what kind of themes, what kind of hosting you're on. So I'm going to put an analogy for you. So imagine a nice, beautiful apartment like this. I would love to have such an apartment. You know where the doors are. One leads to the balcony, one leads to the front end, the corridor. It's easy to secure those doors. Now if you get windows, there are grills and so on. This is like WordPress. It is small, it is secure, it is good. It works everything for you. You don't have care. But as you start installing plugins and themes, and then you start doing all the random nonsense, not nonsense, but you want to improve your website, it becomes a little bit like a huge castle. So it's grand, and then someone visits your site, they think, well, that's a beautiful website. But it becomes a castle that probably has, say, a 5,000 year history, and then you have no idea whether there are hidden tunnels. You have no idea which rooms are locked, which rooms are not. You have no idea whether there are more than one entrances. There's probably more than one. So the point is, you are one tiny person inside this huge castle that you have no idea where everywhere leads to. So WordPress websites that get hacked are usually WordPress websites that become like castles, where the user or the web maintainer doesn't actually keep it up and just keeps installing stuff, and stuff like that. So there's only one single way, which is, I think, a common topic that all WordPress people talk about, to keep your WordPress site absolutely 100% safe, is to take it offline. It's like just a big wall around it and no one can access it. If you take it offline, you're probably not, maybe even back then, you're not 100% safe. So if you want, so WordPress itself is as secure as your plugins, theme, and hosting combined, right? I'm gonna skip one slide. Okay, so what I wanna talk about, how do WordPress websites get hacked? Now I like to say this, actually by choice. So by choice of choosing a bad hosting, by choice of choosing a bad password, which is actually quite common, choice of choosing a random plugin that you've seen over the net that someone says, this is awesome, please download it and install it into your website, and by not upgrading your WordPress, right? So this is actually what we do at the WordPress.org support forums. We see these four issues all the time. And then some guy is gonna say, I got hacked, what do I do? And then he's gonna say, this is my admin password. He's gonna paste it on the forums, and he's asking people to log in to check it for him, right? And then more often than not, here's a terrible thing. They will use something like ABCD1234, right? So just to quickly run through, why is a simple password bad? If I were to guess 1234 ABCD, probably easy. But if you just do something a little bit more complicated, I can guess it. But I could write a script that continues to try to guess your password, and that actually can go through, say, 1,000 iterations per 10 seconds, maybe, even if you do it on a slow server. If you do it on a multiple setup, you probably can iterate through hundreds of thousands of passwords per an hour. So strong passwords are important, and you don't have to think about very complicated, like a crazy number sequence plus symbols plus text. Those are good. But you could use a good makeup. For example, what is your favorite person in the world, plus your favorite date, plus your favorite dog's name and so on. Make a story around it, they'll help you remember. And as long as it's long enough, with a good mix of numbers and whatnot, it's gonna be safe, it's gonna be secure. So that's the kind of password you wanna choose. I'm gonna show you a quick demo on, not demo yet. So then themes and plugins. If you actually download a plugin from WordPress.org, it is about 95%, 99% maybe safe. But bear in mind, at WordPress.org, we allow plugin authors to update their plugins. So if they make a bad decision after our first evaluation, we don't always catch it, because in the end, the plugin team is made up of 5 people to cover 37,000 plugins in the plugin repository. So we don't always catch it, so you have to be a little bit careful about what you're downloading. That, but definitely try not to download some random plugin hosted out of WordPress.org, because that probably isn't safe. Upgrade to WordPress, that's key, and I'm going to tell you this, that we have an auto security update system right now. So if you realize your version 4.5 websites are updated to version 4.5.1, those are what we do to patch the security issues. But if you actually have, say, 4.4 to 4.5, there may be security bugs that we are trying to fix, but we cannot tell it to you. Because if we tell everyone that, oh, we are going to update the 4.5 because there's a big security bug, all the hackers are going to attack all the version 4.4 sites. Yeah. So we probably hide it inside one of our updates. So it's good to update to make sure that you get it all. And then the last thing, bad hosting. This is actually one of the key issues. People go online and they see, oh, this is a $5 or $1.99 per month for hosting, and then they think that they're going to get something good out of it. If it looks too cheap, it's probably bad. Yeah. So don't go for those. Go for reputable hosting companies. And if your website is actually a money-generating website or it's very important to you, maybe get one that's not shared hosting. Because if a website, for a host to turn a profit around, probably has to put about 200 websites into one server. If they don't set the server up properly, one website gets hacked, the rest of the websites go down the drain as well. So it's good for you to make sure that if you are actually having a website that generates money, put it into a more secure server that's, you know, guaranteed by one of the hosts out there. So I'm going to show you one very quick demo. Okay. Oh, I need internet connection. Just give me a second.
Yes. Is there Microsoft free Wi-Fi? Yes, yeah. You don't, I don't think you have the login.
Okay, I might use mine.
Yeah, the last one.
Yeah. You can see your password. Bing, yay, Bing. So if you don't like passwords, there are various ways to get around it. So I like to recommend this. This is Clef. So it's the same thing, you log in through the WordPress backend. But you have this mobile app called CLEF. And then you can actually use a fingerprint or you can use a passcode on your phone to unlock it. So let me log up first. Yeah. So you get this barcode kind of thing that moves around. And then you can sort of just point it at the screen and then locks it in. Yeah. So you never ever need to use a password again. Yeah.
For the front end, it doesn't show this, though, right? For
the, no. Yeah.
They'll still be able to...
Oh. Yes. You can, of course, choose a dual login system. So for example, one of the cool things that I like to do here is actually I use one single system to log into multiple websites. So if I'm at home, I realize, shit, I didn't log out of one of the computers, I can press log out here, and then it's logged out. So let's see whether it's logged out. So you see, I'm logged out again. So if you want to use password, you can just click login with password and goes to the normal screen. Yeah. So it's what I usually do for my clients is I secure the administrator with this, yeah, and it can't be hacked. So that's one way to get a good secure login. The other way is you can use two-factor authentication. And I would like to let you know that WordPress Core is going to put in two-factor authentication by default very soon, maybe in version 4.6, as soon as version 4.6, maybe. So I'm going to quickly share with you types of vulnerabilities, and there's a lot of code behind. I'm going to skip those, but if you want to know about it, talk to me. So there's the cross-site request forgery, there's cross-site scripting, and SQL injection. There's actually a lot more, but these are the three main types. So what's CSRF? So imagine this, if you look at this code, I'm not going to go through the code. Imagine you have a piece of code, but it's supposed to forward you to the PayPal website. But because you did not secure your website properly, I managed to put something in that forwards all your users to my fake PayPal website. So that fake PayPal website records your login, and I'm going to record your login. I'm going to copy that login, and I'm going to go PayPal.com, and I'm going to start buying myself a big TV and so on. So this is what cross-site request forgery is. You don't have to really understand this, especially if you're a user, but one thing that you could talk to your developer who's going to make your site and so on is, it's your site CSRF safe? You don't have to really understand it. So for developers, there's an easy way to prevent that, is we use this number used once. So WordPress generates a secret code, secret length of string that takes this number of items and generates that string. So that string is so random that it cannot be duplicated. So which means you cannot forward me to a wrong place and so on by using this with, say, user capabilities. So one way to get around CSRF is by using numbers used once. I'm gonna skip that. Okay, then we have cross-site scripting. This is actually the most common type of vulnerability. So the thing about cross-site scripting is that I can insert a JavaScript code to do anything that I want. So the key thing that what people will do is actually they will steal login passwords. So after they steal your admin login password, they can actually go into your admin panel and buy just normally because they know your login password right now. And then they can create a new administrator account for themselves. After which, if your website is not that secure, they can actually write files into it to hide the admin account. Then they forever have an admin account into the website. And I want to let you know that cross-site scripting, SQL injection, CSRF, they are not WordPress specific. They are web specific. So you have a website online, they are all open to all this. So actually, a lot of times WordPress websites get hacked. It is not because it's WordPress. It is because of this. And it applies to all websites in the world. So I'm not going to cover the code again. Okay, so what can cross-site scripting do? It can allow you to create a new administrator account. It can change your password without you knowing it. I can start installing new plugins and themes. And if you have your file editor available in your WordPress website, and when you go home, maybe one of the things you should do is disable the file editor on the WordPress admin. I can use that file editor to add in secret lines into the code, and you will never know. Yeah. So actually, as I was telling you, I had this first client a long time ago. And then one thing that the hacker did was actually, if I visited the site by typing the name itself, no issues. But if someone found their website through Google, it will check the referral. Like if the site knows that you're coming from Google, it will redirect them to another website. So as the site admin and my client, they will never know because they will type the name in. So this is to prevent you from knowing. But people who are looking for the business, yes, they will actually search that and then they will find out. And then they will get redirected. They have no idea why they're redirected, but now they're screwed as well because the site probably installed something on their computer. So that's cross-site scripting. And then... yes?
Going into the site itself already, activates the malicious software.
For example, if the site itself, okay, when you actually go onto a website, what your browser does is actually it downloads all the JavaScript, all the HTML required items, the images and so on. So let's say the JavaScript is actually infected, and so on, which is not so bad because it doesn't run on anything else. But it could very well ask you to download a file that looks okay. And then people who are actually typing fast, they press enter fast. That's what they're aiming for, chance. And then you install the file or you download the file, and then one day some guy clicks it. That's it. So by actually visiting it, it's not going to be like that. But if you were, say, using a very old browser and it's got a lot of security holes, they could attack those security holes.
So meaning to be infected by malicious software, you have to click.
If you are on a modern operating system and modern browser, you probably have to click it to be infected. So we have SQL injection. you don't need to bother about the code, but imagine this, you have a text box. The text box contacts the database. So now, instead of you me searching for something in the database, I'm actually putting in a database code. So by putting two database code together, the system thinks that you're running a special line. So actually, with this SQL injection, I can maybe download a full list of all your users without you knowing. I could download a full list of all your admin passwords and so on. I could download a full list of all your e-commerce content, e-commerce purchases and so on, without you knowing it. I could also be very mean. I could write an SQL statement to contact the database and I can drop your entire database. And if you have no backup, pretty screwed. Especially if you're running an e-commerce website, I could drop all your users, all your purchases, so you have no idea what's going on. So that's the what SQL injection can do. So all these slides are going to actually be on the speaker deck. Yeah, so you can actually download it from there, don't worry about that. And a lot of this code, if you're actually interested in studying, you can look at it. This code is actually provided by one of my fellow WordPress core committer guy. Who actually gave a talk about security at WordCamp Lancaster, actually. So, I'm going to skip the whole SQL injection thing. So there are a few ways to avoid this. If you're a developer, really, there are very little use cases to actually write your own SQL statement in WordPress, because you could use the WordPress class objects and query system like WordPress WP query, which will effectively write the SQL statement for you. So you don't actually have to write your own SQL statement. And then for users, if you're developing a new website, you're hiring a new developer, make sure they use WordPress native functions. Because a lot of these developers, they don't actually know WordPress, but they know PHP. So they write PHP and then they will write their own SQL statements, which are usually not safe. Because the truth is, most programmers understand PHP, but to write an effective, good SQL statement or to actually, even if you don't talk about security, to make sure the SQL statement is actually optimized, you probably need a database engineer who's going to write a very nice statement or and so on. And then a lot of times, actually, some plugins will create their own tables and so on, and usually it is not needed. Unless it's a massive plugin, say like WooCommerce as a e-commerce system. They will run their own tables. They may have their own SQL statements and so on, but those are usually vetted by professionals. So the takeaway for the, I think I skipped some stuff, but never mind. So the takeaway for you, if you're a developer, don't trust user input. Always assume that someone's going to abuse your system, and so on. If you're users, ask the developers if, just remember this, that if they have taken appropriate CSRF, XSS, SQLi preventions. Just send them this line. And then it's like asking a local butcher if they have gotten the meat checked. Yeah, it's a simple thing to say. And if they assure you they've done it, then at least you can hold them to that statement. If your site gets hacked, you can screw them upside down. So,
I think you can go through the XSS.
Sorry?
XSS.
Oh, so XSS solutions, I'm going to go through the best practices which actually helps with that. Yeah. So best practices, and I'm going to go through it a little bit fast. Number one, keep upgrading. Like I said, WordPress sometimes hides security updates without telling you. So there was a version, major version, version 4.2 to 4.3. I think we hit a huge security update in the form of emojis. Yeah. So a lot of people were upset with emojis, but actually those were a security fix. So things like that. And then you need to check for intent. For example, did they want to edit the post or did they want to delete the post? And you can do this with the numbers used once. And then you need to do sanitizing and escaping. So I have more slides on that. So keep upgrading. So I want to point out, I'm going to go through sanitizing and escaping later on, but I want to point out a use case that I went through. So on forums, right, on the WordPress.org forums, there's this guy who said that after he developed a website, the developer told him that he cannot update WordPress. Yeah. So, which is fairly quite common in developers worldwide, because they've edited a core file, or they have done something really wrong, and they are maybe just scared that their customizations will not last against the new WordPress versions. So they told him, you cannot update. And then they actually set a white line and say that they will return it to a virgin install. So, which is not true. So I went ahead and told him that with WordPress, that we encourage you to do it properly, use child themes, and if you need to override a plugin, write another plugin instead. And then the key thing is that we strongly encourage people to update their WordPress installation. So what I want you to take around here is that I told him, take this line and then send it to your developer and tell him to fix it. So what happened was that sent him replies and he updated the site to the latest. And back then, the latest version was 4.4.2. Yeah, and he got it settled. Yeah. So of course, the developer is going to fix the three plugins that stopped working. But the key thing for users to take around here right now is that if you go out and hire a developer, he's going to tell you that do not update. If let's say you get a developer who tells you not to update WordPress, do not trust the developer, tell him to make your system safe for updating. So that's one key thing. So one of the things that people are worried about is that if I update my WordPress core system, what about plugins that are not ready for it? So I wanted to show you that actually the plugins team, they sent an email to all the plugin authors, all 37,000 of them, and say that, okay, WordPress 4.5 is scheduled to be released in the next few days. Are you guys ready to update? Yeah. So a lot of times, actually during this period, a lot of plugins get updated. Because we know this because the server starts getting really slow. And then commits start slowing down and everything like that. So all the plugin authors, they will tell them, so your plugins that's not up to version 4.2, do you want to check it and make sure that it's updated to 4.5? So, which means plugins that you download from the WordPress.org repository are more or less usually safe for updating. Yeah. And if you are not sure, don't worry, because just wait a few more days, they will update it. Yeah. So one of the key things that you should learn as a developer is that love your users, but don't trust them on using the correct system correctly. Because one of the things that could happen would be, say you have an infected browser that's secretly inputting a bunch of malicious code in all your text boxes that you visit. So you don't know that it's inserting that, but it is doing it. So that could happen. So while your user is a nice person, but his computer is infected, so you never know. So don't trust your user, and maybe it's not even your user, it's just a hacker running a bot and testing all your text boxes. So a few ways to prevent such stuff, you can do sanitization. So if you do sanitization, you will sanitize early, because you will pass that variable around. And when you do sanitization, you want to understand what content do you want. For example, if I'm searching for, say, phone numbers. Now, there's only numbers inside it. Then maybe I can just run it through an integer value function, which then checks and converts all string into integer. So effectively, it lets me know that, okay, whatever value that I get out of this is bound to be a number, then it should be safe. There are many sanitization functions that you can use, say sanitize text view and so on. There's sanitize HTML and various other functions that you can use. You can check this web page, and then it will give you actually the list of all sanitization functions that you can use in your system. So sanitization is effectively just taking whatever user has inputted and cleaning them. Yeah, it doesn't always necessarily clean them at 100%, but it does some to some level. So you should also escape. So escaping is for both encoding conversion and also to maybe drop certain things. So if you're escaping, you should always escape late, because while you're running the system, maybe in the middle, the variables still get passed around. If you escape them too early, then they are now converted and they cannot be used for any other functions anymore. Or even if you use them, they are not accurate anymore. In escaping, you need to understand the context. What is the thing going to be used for? For example, if you are going to print out a link, you should use escape URL. It will convert the HTML entities for you. If you are going to print out something, like the comments with the nice formatting, the bold and the bullet points, you should use Escape HTML. It will allow the safe HTML text to go through, and then it will probably help you deter the unsafe ones. Again, you can look at this link for all the related escape functions. So I did not include this into the slide itself, but there's a very important WordPress function called WP underscore KSES. KSES means Q Silver Scripts. So it's a very powerful sanitization tool. You can use it to clean about anything that deals with user input. So you can use that to clean before you insert into your database. So I think last two things I'm going to talk about. Number one is SSL. So if you notice some sites, if you visit, especially e-commerce websites, they have HTTPS. And I'm just going to show you a quick demo. So this is my client site. So if you have an SSL or you say HTTPS, and then you have a green lock. So this lets people know that your site is secure. So why is SSL important? So SSL is important because if you are, say, at a public Wi-Fi area, you're at Starbucks, you're using public Wi-Fi. If you are typing your password in, it's your own computer, but it passes through the public Wi-Fi, someone can actually intercept the data. You can steal your password and log in. Same thing, he can then log into your website and he can start doing some random nonsense to it. So, and if he was smart, you will never know. You will never know that your password was stolen. He'll be constantly logging in as you, and you'll never ever know. So to prevent that, you should install SSL on your website. So with SSL, which turns your HTTP into HTTPS as being secure, all the stuff, for example, your passwords and so on, right, will be encrypted. So even if he intercepts it, he gets an encrypted nonsense that no one understands. So you never have to worry about your website, the data, your login, especially, let's say, your e-commerce website. It's not just about you, it's about the 5,000 e-commerce shoppers that are using your website. So their, passwords cannot be stolen. And you may think, hey, if you go to a coffee shop and you go to Starbucks, you probably wouldn't log in that much, right? It's a very small risk. But it's not true, because if you think about it in the Starbucks context, one of the actually biggest places to steal data is actually at big conferences, big fairs and so on. So they will go there, people who want to steal passwords, they wait there, they will start getting all this data. Later on, when they go back, they have a huge amount of logins and passwords to various systems. So it's important to make sure your site is HTTPS. And then it is not just about making it secure. The cool thing about SSL now is that it allows you to have HTTP/2, which actually makes your site really, really, really fast. So it doesn't work with normal without SSL, but with that, actually allows you to load a site very fast. This is how right now most websites work. You get the new request for the website, but the website sends you one file by one file. Admittedly, very fast, but it's always one file by one file before you get everything. But with HTTP2, I can do multiple requests and get them at the same time. Which means that if I have a file in the middle that's huge, it doesn't actually wait for the file to finish downloading before I load the rest of the site. And I'm going to show you a demo. Effectively, websites should work fast like this. If it's slow, it's not my business, it's the Wi-Fi. But let's say if you select this and you look at Singapore, it should look immediately. With many, many images, it doesn't matter. If let's say I look at Buffetware, it should load immediately as well. And this is all because of SSL and HTTP2. So I'm just going to show you one last example. So this is the e-commerce website. It's another of my clients. And then if you click on a product, it should load immediately. If you click on another product, it should load, the same product. If you click on another product, it should load immediately. So you should. This is the kind of experience you should get through all of your websites, if you actually implement all this properly. And the cool thing about SSL, and actually Robert presented about 2 months ago or one 2 months ago, SSL now can be gotten through Let's Encrypt. It's free. So with Let's Encrypt, and let's say you get a host that supports it, it's all free, your site will become blazing fast. So the cool thing about that is also, it is not just about a site being blazing fast. It is, if your site is really, really fast, as Google ranks you higher, and then you get more visibility as well. So it's a plus-plus situation. It's secure, it's fast, and Google ranks you higher. So, and it's free, yeah. So please, if you go back, one of the things that you can do if you are on a shared host or anything like that, maybe just ask your host, how can I get SSL onto my site? And then how can I enable HTTP2 for the site? So they'll settle all this for you. If your host doesn't want to do this for you, switch to a new host. Switch to something else. Okay. And the last thing I want to talk about is reporting security exploits. So, if you actually find a security problem, whether it's a plugin or theme or WordPress itself, there are a few places that you can go to. I'm sorry about the title. So if it's a plugin, try to contact the plugin author. A lot of the authors on WordPress repo, they are quite responsive. Especially the very big plugins, the very popular plugins, they'll respond to you. You can usually go to their website and use a contact form, and they will contact you. If they don't respond, contact plugins@wordpress.org. So you just send them how you managed to find out about this exploit. If it's a theme, contact the theme author, but don't worry too much, because themes that you download from WordPress.org pretty much only are allowed display code. They are not allowed to do database stuff and things like that. So they are less likely, very, very less likely to have security issues. And if it's WordPress core, send an email to security@wordpress.org. And if you're a developer, sometimes you realize this, actually, I've done this before with other content management systems, I've done this with other communities, but they don't actually reply me, they don't let me know what's going on. The cool thing about this is that they do. So I actually sent this last year, one of the security issues, and I sent it to the security@wordpress.org. And then, straight away, in the same day, if you notice the mail dates, they replied. And they say that the security issue is a bogus, don't worry about it. Which is good for us, because now we can tell the users that that's a fake security issue, and everyone can relax. So this is actually really meant, there's many people watching the security email that you will send, of course in private. And the cool thing about maintaining security for WordPress is that if we find out, we fix it, you guys get an update, your sites are protected too. So it's a good thing to do. So that's the end of my talk. Do you have any questions? I would love to listen to them.
Yeah, about the WP admin page.
Yes.
And you said you have Clef, right?
Yeah.
But there's still the option, it says click here to log in with password.
Yes.
So I guess I haven't been able to understand so far, is there a way to secure WP admin from brute force attacks? Because I mean, they could write a script to just click the password and then try hundreds of thousands.
You can. So Clef allows you to disable passwords entirely. Yeah.
Okay.
So this one. Second thing, if you are a server level person, you can install fail to ban, and then by making fail to ban read WordPress logs, it can detect multiple login failures, and then it can ban the IP. So that's one key way of protecting against brute force attacks. So unfortunately, about brute force attacks, it's not that easy to protect against. But there's a very good plugin called Jetpack. A lot of you might have heard that Jetpack is bloated, but actually Jetpack allows you to switch on and off multiple modules. Jetpack has now this very powerful brute protect function built into it. So you could just install Jetpack, it's free. Register with WordPress.com for an account to link Jetpack, and you're done. So WordPress.com will use their servers to protect your installation against brute force attacks.
So I have Jetpack on almost most of my sites, and I have something called WordFence.
Yes.
Are they pretty good too? I mean, it seems like the features they were offering in combination, I mean, I couldn't think of how much more security you could get, because that was doing sort of the thing with, you could, after three failed login attempts, you can block the user and things like that.
Yeah. But you see, the tough part about that is that WordFence works at the PHP level, so it's higher than the server level, which means that by the time you realize the attack is going on, or by the time it started to block people, you could have been attacked for a while already. So and by then, PHP may have been taxed like crazy, and it started using a lot of RAM, and then maybe even going out of memory, which is not good. So if you are really doing up a website that has so much brute force attacks, you should do it at a server level. So fail to ban would be one good way to start off to do that. So if you say moving your site to a VPS, you can ask them to install fail to ban and ask them to monitor WordPress. And fail to ban will actually handle all this banning for you and so on. Yeah.
And there's no way to sort of hide the WP admin directory from a front end. Like, mm-hmm. I've read blogs say that move the WP config file out of your folder, but I don't know what that would do because I.
Right.
So
I'm a proponent against, I'm an opponent against security via obscurity. So by pretending there's no issue, for example, like hiding WP-admin, it's essentially like the ostrich putting the head in the sand. It doesn't really do anything. Because if they wanted to, they will still find a login, and they will still attack. So the only thing it does is actually it gives you a false sense of security. Yeah. So my view is that hiding WP-admin does nothing at all. And if essentially this is a website that you want no one to log into, put a server level password to that page instead. So before you log into WP admin, you actually have to put a password that's accepted by the web server. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So they cannot attack that. No matter how much they attack that, it doesn't do anything because it doesn't load WordPress with resources. The server first detects it and does nothing except, do you have a password? Yeah. So why is attacking WordPress itself so taxing on your server? Because when you load the WP-admin page, you usually load a lot of WordPress resources, even though you only see the password page. So when they attack that over and over again, they're just forcing the server to load WP-admin over and over and over again. Yeah. So if you are having all these issues, go at the server level, because doing it at the WordPress level is not going to help you. Like I said, your site is only as secure as your server, which is your server hosting, WordPress, plugins, and themes combined. So if plugin and themes are already secured and you are sure that everything else is okay, go at the server level. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, cool. Yes?
How do you go to the server level?
So if you're on shared hosting, you might be quite limited. Yeah.
So you need to have a dedicated hosting?
You don't need to have a dedicated server, but you can get an inexpensive virtual private server. Virtual private server. So and those can actually be quite good. So if you're running a website, say like an e-commerce website or a company website, even if your company is not a big massive company, you can use a VPS, and the cheapest VPS go for $10 USD per month. The cheapest is $5. Yeah, at DigitalOcean. But those are, you have to understand servers to actually set it up. The next cheapest managed VPS, that means you get the staff at the company to manage the virtual private server for you, to set up everything for you. The only thing you have to do is watch your website. The cheapest I know is $29 USD per month.
Dreamhost?
Yeah, Dreamhost. Yeah. So, to me, if you want to run a website, $29 USD per month, not a big sum. Yeah, especially if the website is important for you. Because you must understand that hosting virtual private servers used to be 100 plus USD per month. Now it's 29. Yeah. So think about that, because you can get them to secure the servers, and if there's any issue, they will fix it for you, which is cool. Yeah. If you go for shared hosting, they will not do anything to help you. They will just let you die. Yeah. Any more questions?
So good.
$10 is Linode. You can go there. That's actually quite a popular virtual private server hosting company. But the same thing, you actually need server knowledge to actually set up. Yeah, it's like they give you a blank hardware kind of a thing, and then they ask you to run all these commands that you have to set up your web server, you have to install database, you have to install PHP, you have to secure it and everything like that. Not an easy task to do, but if you want to learn, you can start learning with that. But if you want something managed, you can try Dreamhost managed VPS service. And they actually built that service specifically for WordPress. Yeah.
So Dreamhost
is a 29? Yeah, it's the 29 USD dollar host. So I don't work for them, I just know one of my fellow WordPress colleagues work there. We know each other, so I quite trust them as a hosting entity.
So is that a US or Singapore?
It's a US company. But nowadays, all these VPSs are built very well. So you will not find much latency issues. And if actually your site requires very, very fast speed, you can build load balancers around it. The same way you can just tell them, I'm from Singapore, now I'm visiting this website, there's some level of latency. Could you improve it? They will do something to improve the speed for you as well.
Oh, they can do that.
Yeah, but maybe they'll charge you a little bit more. To do that, but usually, even if your website is hosted in America, and if you set up your stuff properly, it still will be very, very fast. Yeah, yeah.
It's possible. I have a client who's doing it. One of the sites is in France.
Mm-hmm.
Speed is reasonably good to access from Singapore.
Yeah,
yeah. It's already how they set up the servers, how they do the querying and stuff like that. If they cannot do it, the alternative is to put your site on other load balancing services like Cloudflare, where they actually distribute the content worldwide on their own networks, so that when people serve the site, right, they just hit their servers first, which might be located nearer to your end users rather than you. But of course, this is all for static files. Yeah.
So that means there will be less pings, right?
Sorry?
We call it less pings.
Less pings, less latency. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's a service that you have to subscribe to the loop.
Some of them are free, like Cloudflare. It's a content delivery network. It's free. You can use it. Yeah. And I want to show you this, like WordPress.org. This is in the US, but the site is actually very fast. Yeah. So it can be faster, but do we really need such a fast site? So this is actually very fast, and this is hosted in the US.
Mm.
Yeah. So that's my talk. When you go back, I would like you to take a few things into mind. So WordPress is actually very secure. There's no vulnerability that we let go. If we discover anything, we fix it almost immediately. Plugins and themes on WordPress.org here. The repo are usually very safe. We at least do the first level of check. When they first submit the plugin, we check it quite thoroughly. So after that, the plugin authors are given the authority to actually update the plugins. So it's up to them to secure the code after that. Yeah. And keep your WordPress versions updated. Try not to use plugins and themes that you find randomly on other websites. And if you are a developer, make sure to use good WordPress native functions and all the security stuff that you need to secure your code. Last thing you need to take off is, as a developer, don't trust your users, think they're going to mess it up, and secure your code against them. And as users, you know, if you update your WordPress versions all the time, you update your themes and your plugins, your site should really remain relatively safe. Yeah. So. That's all from me, and if you need any help with any specific questions, doesn't need to be related to this topic, can be just related to WordPress or the web development, feel free to talk to me. And thank you for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining.